Good morning, children. Okay, today we'll be moving towards to the chapter that is the Rig Vedic civilization. On this, we will be doing about the religion life of the Rig Vedic Aryans. Okay, religion life, or can be called as mode of worship. Let's see what type of gods who have been worshipped during the early Vedic period by the Rig Vedic Aryans. Okay. Number one mode of worship, that was worship of nature gods, which I had already explained to you in the previous classes, that the ancient Aryans, okay, the ancient Aryans were highly religious, okay, but the religion was very simple. It was not so complicated. The religion was not so complicated like we have in today's time. Okay. The religion was very simple. The Aryans were very much impressed by the nature god. The forces of nature can be called like sun, fire, wind, water, rain, and the earth. These were the one whom they worshipped. Okay. They worshipped the sun, the fire, the wind, the earth, the rain, etc. Now, every natural phenomena, whatever phenomena takes place in the nature, it was been regarded as a separate god. Is it clear? And they were regarded as a separate god. They were been worshipped, and specially they prayed that nature god for their happiness, for their prosperity. Varuna and Indra, try to understand. These two gods were the main gods. Varuna and Indra were the main gods. Agni, Varuna was the chief god who knew all the mysteries of the universe. See, so these were the, I'm telling you, Varuna, Indra, the main gods. They worship Agni, Varuna, okay. And what they used to feel it within themselves, okay, that these two gods, Agni and Varuna, they knew all the mysteries of the universe. Whatever was happening in the universe, okay, whatever the mystery takes place in this universe, the god called Agni and Varuna knew very well. This is according to the belief of the Rig Vedic Aryans. In the Rig Vedic, there are several hymns, especially many hymns have been written, okay. Especially, there are certain hymns which they wanted to forgive for one's sins, as it evident from the following hymn. Say, especially by singing this hymn, okay, which you can find in the Rig Veda, they specially wanted to forgive if anyone has done any mistaken sin, pap, manchani, okay. If anyone has done any type of sin, okay, so please God forgive us. Like in one of this hymn, I'll just read out the same which has been written in Rig Veda. O Varuna, deliver us from the sin of our forefathers. Deliver us from our own sins. I mean, I came on this Bhagavan life. Bhagavan Varuna life. Okay. O God, Varuna, please forgive us from the sin of our forefathers. Hamro forefathers le je pani galti gareko cha, je pani pap gareko cha, tesko lagi hamilai chhama deu. Deliver us from our sin. Hamile je pap gareko chhau. So this type of hymns have been written in Rig Veda. God Indra was worshipped so that he may protect his devotees from the Holocaust. H-O-L-O-C-A-U-S-T. Holocaust. Holocaust means the disorder caused by the war. Is it clear? The destruction. The destruction of war. So, they are praying Indra God, they are worshipping God Indra, so that God Indra may protect his devotees. Devotees are called bhakta. Jo bhakti cha, jale bhakti garcha tyo bhagwan ko, they are called devotees. Okay. So, protect us from these destructions of the war and fill their granaries by sending timely rains. Indra bhagwan, jale chai hamile pani dincha. Okay, oh God, please protect us from the Holocaust of the war, the destruction of the war, and please provide us the timely rain so that we can fill up our granaries. Now, granary refers means the storehouse of grains. As you know very well, most of them, they were the peasants. They used to cultivate. The main occupation was agriculture. So please give us the timely rainfall so we can produce more crops and we can fill up our granaries. This is how they used to worship. This is how they used to pray God Indra. Most of the hymns in the Rig Veda praise this God. See, most of the hymns, okay. Hymns means a type of songs or bhajan kirtan, I want to, okay. It has been written in Rig Veda. Most of the hymns in the Rig Veda, it is praying this God. It specially praise, okay. Yo Bhagwan, God Indra lai praise gareko. On one of the hymns, it says, O Indra, with your help, we will slay our foes. Bhandai sa, O Indra, if you help us, because of your protection, because of your help, we will be succeeded in destroying our foes. F-O-E-S, foes, manikas ke, oh, dusman, enemy. Is it clear? So it has been clearly written, Dear Indra, O Indra, Indra God, please support us. And because of your help, you are with us. Okay, you are with us. So that is the reason why we will slay our foes. Slay, because okay, oh, destroy. We can easily destroy our enemies. So this was the first worship of nature. Unali nature god lai matrai puja garthyo. They used to worship the nature god. Next point number two, that is knowledge of one God. During the time of Rig Vedic Aryans, okay, see, they had a knowledge of one God. Euta ebong answer. Though the Aryans worship several nature gods, malle bhandechu unale pura bhagwan manaudhe, like for example, they used to worship Indra, Varuna, sun, the fire, earth, prithvi ko puja garthyo, okay. Though they worshipped several gods, but yet they believed only one God. They believed only one God, and they used to say that there is only one God who is the source of all the powers vetted with the nature gods. Jati pani power sa yo bhagwan harumati in the nature god, okay, there is only one God, and he is the source of all powers which has been given to the nature gods. The Rig Veda has several hymns in praise of the omnipotent God. Omnipotent bhaneko eutai bhagwan. Is it clear? Who is present everywhere? Omnipresent bhancha talai. Omnipresent. Omnipresent means who is present everywhere. So, the Rig Veda, in the Rig Veda you can find several hymns which has praised the one God who is variously called. Ulai thuprai namle bolaucha. He has been called as Indra, Mitra, Varuna, and Agni. Say, there is only one God, bhandai cha, according to this religion belief of Rig Veda, Aryans. Okay. So, like, for example, I'll give you a simple example. Okay, I'll give you a simple example. Like, for example, okay, in today's time, let me tell you of today's time, okay. In today's time, see, we follow different religion. We follow different religion. Some are Hindus, some are Buddhists, some are Christians, some are Jains. This is clear. Are you understanding? Hindu goes to the temple, Christians goes to the church, Sikh goes to the Gurudwaras, Muslim goes to mosque, Buddhist they goes to monastery to pray God. But finally, we will reach towards to only one God. Okay, like for a simple example I'll give you. Okay, you people all study in the school called Glenmore International, isn't it? So Glenmore International School is situated out here, but you can find different students coming from different places. Okay, some come from this way, some come from this way, another comes from this way. Finally you reach to one place that is called Glenmore International School. So this same thing, the religion is same thing, okay. You follow any sort of religion, is it clear? You follow any sort of path to make your God happy, who can fulfill your needs. Finally, there is only one God. Is it clear? Bato matra begle begle ho. Yo school ma aunu pani hami bhindai bhindai bato bara aunchu. Is it clear? तर लास्टमा कहाँ आउँछु हामी सबै यो स्कुलमा आउँछु. सो सेम थिङ इज इट क्लियर. सेम थिङ हियर गॉड हु इज वेरियसली कॉल्ड इन्द्र, कसैलाई हामीले इन्द्र भनेर बोलाउँछु, कसैलाई मित्र, वरुण, अग्नि, बट देयर इज ओन्ली वान गॉड. Is that clear? So that is the knowledge of one God. Eutai Matre Bhagwan sir. And that God is the source of all the powers which is vetted with the all the nature gods. Second point. Point number three. According to the mode of worship of the Rigvedic Aryans, that is singing of hymns. The Aryans' way of worship was very simple. I'd already told you before, cell phone. Their religious life was very simple. I mean, it's not so complicated like we have in today's time. Their way of worship was very, very simple. They had not built any temples as is done this day, nor did they worship idols. Today, when we have to worship, we have a place of worship. Mandir sa, masjid sa, gumba sa, chot sa. Is it clear? But during that time of Aryans, they did not build any temples. Unale kune mandir pani banayena, which we have in today's days. Nor did they worship idols. Idols worship garthena unale. Idol worship bhaneko murti ko puja. Okay. Anyway you go, any places worship you go, either it's in Buddhism or Christianity or Hinduism, any place of worship you go to the temple, you can find idol. Today, idol worship is prevalent. But during those days, they did not worship idols. Murti ko puja garthe na. They recited mantras or hymns in the open air. Ekdam khulla jaga ma mantra parthyo unale. Mantra jap garthyo. Is it clear? They recited mantras or hymns. They used to sing the hymns in the open air. And all the members of the families took part in the chanting the hymns. See, everyone was to be present out there when they were chanting the hymns. Mantra parda. Singing of hymns, okay, it was done in the open air, I told you, because there was no temples, not at all. They didn't worship any idols, okay. So, all the families, they took part in the chanting the hymns. Now, point number four, yajnas, once hami, yajnas and sacrifices, okay. Point to be noted out here. Yajna, havan, hami puja garda euta havan last ma. In, at the end of the puja, ke garcha priestle havan launcha, home launcha, okay, telai bhancha yajna. Yajna or havana, burning incense was the major part of their religious duty. See, to burn the incense sticks maneko dhup kaati, okay, to burn the incense sticks was the most important part of their religious duty. The daily yajnas were very simple. See, they used to perform yajnas daily, but remember the yajnas which were being performed by the Aryans in those days, it was very simple and it was performed by the family members themselves. Family members harule afi bhela bhayera yajnas perform garthyo. It was not so complicated. Besides this, daily yajnas, they perform special yajnas on festival days. See, every day they used to perform the yajnas. All the family members, they participated in the yajnas. They performed the yajnas by all the family members. But besides the daily yajnas, unale daily yajnas pani garthyo. But besides these yajnas, on the festival days, kunai festival, char bar ma, they used to perform a special yajnas. Now, it has been said, sometimes animals were sacrificed on these occasions. Okay. I completely condemned on the sacrifice of the animals on those occasions, specially. When the special yajnas were being done on festivals, these they used to sacrifice animals. Now, there was a belief. I mean, early later Vedic, Pusakara, later Vedic, in the later Vedic also, there was a very much belief that animal sacrifices has to be done. Aba hamile animal sacrifice kina ta garne? Why? Question mark auncha tyanira. There's a great question, why we are sacrificing animals in front of God or goddesses? A simple answer came to satisfy the god or a goddesses. Bhansa, later Vedic period, I'm telling you, okay, in the later Vedic period, we'll come about this. They used to say that if we will sacrifice animals in front of God or goddesses, then the God and goddesses will be pleased. The God and goddesses will be happy. And whatever the demand we have kept before them, our demand will be fulfilled. I am completely against this. Because according to my point of view, see, each and every living beings, each and every living things, from a small creature towards to the largest creature, every living thing is being created by the Almighty God. One point to be remembered out here. Every living creature is being created by the Almighty God. And remember one thing. When we are destroying the creation of the Creator, do you think so that Creator will be happy with you? No, not at all. They will not be happy. Because they had created. Unali created God. Create God ko vastulai. Hamile unarko chema destroy gardai chu. Do you think so they will be happy? See, this is all our blind faith. Andabishwas bancha Allah. But also nevertheless, even in this time, sometimes, not every day, animals were being sacrificed on these occasions. Special care was taken in performing these yajnas, lest the gods should get displeased. See, they used to say that when they were performing yajnas, the Aryans used to take a very, very special care. Because, see, if you, while you are performing the yajnas, any mistake you will make it, then this will displease the God. Bhagwan happy hudaina. So, when you are performing the yajnas, you have to perform with a very, very special care. First of all, fire was kindled and offerings of ghee, milk and rice were made. See, pahila ke garthyo? They used to make a bundle of fire. I am just the bonfires of the also daura haru rakhera aago banauthyo. And on that fire, they used to offer the mixture of ghee, milk, rice. Ghee, dud, chamal ko mixture banauthyo. Okay. And that was been offered on that fire. The soma was also offered to God and it was not considered evil. Soma. S-O-M-A. Soma. Let's see what it is. Soma is a type of drink. Is it clear? Soma is a type of drink and it has been said that even during those days, they used to offer soma to God and that was not considered evil. See, they had a faith. Unala biswas thiyo hamile soma, a type of drink. Bhagwanlai chhorayo bhane yo evil haina. That was a faith. That was the faith they had. They thought that the God themselves are fond of soma. So what they used to believe is that the God is fond of soma. Unale soma. Jun chha tyo drink thiyo euta. Okay. Simple Nepali ma aile hami bhanchu roxy type of. Okay. It is the intoxicating drinks. Okay. Unale testo soma jasto banauthyo. Okay. That they used to offer to the God and they used to say that the God were fond of soma. The yajnas or sacrifices were performed to propitiate the gods who in turn would bless their people with peace and prosperity. See, especially, why? Why they used to perform yajnas or sacrifices? Just to please the God. Just to make the God happy. Just to make the God satisfied. They used to perform yajnas and sacrifices. And in return, they had a belief that if you perform sacrifices or if you perform yajnas in a very, very good care, then the God will bless you with peace and prosperity. Santi dincha timalai Bhagwan le. That is what they believe. Is it clear? So, this was all the religion life of the Rigvedic Aryans. The mode of worship. Is it clear? They worship the nature God. They had a knowledge of one God. They used to sing the hymns and the mantras. And finally, yajnas and sacrifice were being done in the daily basis. Especially on the special day, special yajnas were being performed on the festivals. Is it clear? Okay. So, that's all about the religion life of the Rigvedic Ved, that is the mode of their worship. Now, let us come to the most important point, that is political organization and administration. administration of the Rig Vedic Aryans. Okay. So let's see, how were the political organized? How were the administration organized of the Rig Vedic Aryans? Okay. Okay. Now let us come. Let us come and try to understand the political organization. Number one. Number one was the status of king. Status of king. Now let's see. Let's try to understand. The early Aryans live in tribes. Unhari euta group ma basthyo. Tribes bhanthyo. Okay. Which were called Janas. J-A-N-A-S. This has to be noted, dear student. The earlier Aryans lived in tribes, and those tribes were called Janas. Each Jana has its own chief or king who was generally a hereditary successor. Ab each Jana. Suppose let's say yo unarko Aryan ka area bhayo. Is it clear? Yo Aryan ka area bhayo. Ek ek ora area was been divided into Jana tribe. Is it clear? Is it clear? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. ऐसे divide करते हो. यो एल्लाई चाहिए क्या बनते हो? Jana or a tribe. Is it clear? And each Jana, एउटा area मा एउटा chief or king बनते हो. To look after this area. Is it clear? To look after this area, a king or a chief was there. And remember, the chief and the king of each Jana was hereditary successor. Hereditary successor maneko, if the father is the king, now others will not succeed him, his son will succeed him as a king. Usko badma uske chora hunu parcha tyanera raja. Is that clear? But in case the king proved to be cruel, but remember, try to understand one point. If it has been proved that the king of a certain Jana is very cruel, it has been proved to be cruel, then they had the right to replace him by another chosen king. Etti bela chai, the king can be removed and another king can be chosen. But the king has to be proved to be cruel. Suppose the king cruel bhayo bhanera prove bhayo, then another king will be chosen for this Jana. Is it clear? The king had to seek and secure the help of his people for this, his own safety against other contenders or also against his enemies. See, out here, the king had to take a help from his people so that he will be protected against another contenders. Another contenders, bhaneko, jo pani arko manche cha who wanted to be the king. Contenders, opposition, bhanchu hami. Or if any enemies are there, to protect himself from other contenders and from his enemies, the king has to take the help from his people. The king was not an autocrat. Ab yanira, all the authority was not in the hand of the king. Try to understand. Especially monarchy government matestu huncha nta. In monarchy government, all and all power ko huncha raja. The king will be all and all power. His words will be the law. Ule je bolcha tyo kanun huncha. Tyo ho monarchy system. Tyo ho autocrat. Tyo ho dictatorship. Just Hitler ko thiyo ni dictatorship. Tara yahanira ke bhandaicha, the king was not an autocrat. He could exercise limited authority. See, usko power thiyo, but a limited power was been given him to discharge his duties. Is it clear? His duty was to defend his people. His duty was to protect his people. His duty was to give justice to his people. And his duty was to lead them in war. Laraima lead garne kaam raja ko. Is it clear? To give the justice to the people, it was the duty of the king. And to protect the people, it was the duty of the king. He could realize some taxes to meet his expenses. He could collect some taxes so that he could meet his certain expenses. Usko kharcha ko lagi, he used to collect certain taxes. त्यो भयो स्टेटस अफ द किङ. यति बेला बुझ्नुपर्छ तिमीहरूले, द किङ वाज नट एन ऑटोक्रैट. दो इट वाज हेरिडिटरी, इफ द किङ वाज बिन प्रुव्ड क्रुएल, अनदर किङ कुड बी चुजन इन्स्टेड अफ द्याट पर्टिकुलर पर्सन. इज दट क्लियर? एन्ड द किङ हेज टु कम्प्लिटली डिपेन्ड अपन द पिपल टु डिफेन्ड हिमसेल्फ फ्रम हिज अदर कन्टेन्डर्स एन्ड अगेन्स्ट हिज एनिमिज. द किङ डिड नट ह्याड एब्सोल्युट पावर. यहाँ ऑटोक्रैट छैन. King did not have absolute power. A limited power was given to the king. And his duties, let's see what were his duties. His duties were to protect the people. His duties was to give justice to the people. And his duty was to lead the people in the war. Okay. Now, second point. Okay. We are in the political organization. Got it? The second point, the king and his ministers. Okay, let us try to find it out. What are the function of the kings and the ministers, okay, during the Aryans, during the Rig Vedic Aryans? See, there were many ministers. Several ministers were there, especially the commander-in-chief. Aber yo, this is the how the king and his ministers were been organized. Several ministers were there, but the special one was known as commander-in-chief and purohit pantyo, priest. Okay, commander-in-chief and purohit, they were the ones, specially these two. This can be noted down, dear children. Commander-in-chief and the purohit, they were the one to help the king to discharge his administrative duties. Yanira, jati pani administrative duties haru garnu parcha king le, he has to get the help from the commander in chief and purohit. As these ministers were highly experienced and quite able, they could serve their people by giving proper advice to the king. See, these two, specially ma bhandai chu, let us focus on these two ministers. Okay, though there were several ministers, I was telling you, commander in chief and purohit special. Why these two were special then? Why these two were special? Because these two were very experienced in their duties. Skilled, highly experienced, and they were able to give a proper advice to the king how to look after their people, how to serve their people. A very good advice were been given to the king by these two ministers, commander-in-chief and purohit. Without his ministers, a king was like a bird without its wings. If these ministers were not there, if these two ministers were not there who could give a very good advice to the king, without these ministers, the king was just like a bird without its wings. Mane pachi, if there is no wings, chara ko wings hai chana mane chara unnu sakcha sakdaina. Same thing, the king used to be useless without his ministers. Got it? So, this was, I told you about the status of the king. I told you about the king and his ministers. Now, let me go towards to the third political organization, or can be called as administration, local self-government. The third point, okay? Please note it down. The third point, that is local self-government. Local self-government means ke raicha ta? Let us try to understand. Okay, local self-government. Local self-government, during this period, local self-government was an important institution. Eti bela, during the period of the Rig Vedic Aryans, local self-government was a very, very important institution. The Gramini was the chief functionary in a village. The whole village administration was his responsibility. Euta particular village ma ko hunthyo, head of that village was called as Gramini. Try to understand. The most important functionary in a particular village was Gramini, and the whole village administration, jati pani tyo village ko rules and regulations, law and order hunu parcha, sab kasko hat ma thyo? Gramini ko. He had a very vast responsibility in the village administration. He was the one to maintain the peace and order in the village, and in times of the war, lead the people to the battlefield. अरे ग्रामिनीको फंक्शन के रहेछ, ट्राई टु अन्डरस्ट्यान्ड द मेन फंक्सन अफ द ग्रामिनी. हिज फंक्सन वाज टु मेन्टेन पिस एन्ड अर्डर इन द भिलेज, भिलेजमा शान्ति ल्याउने काम ग्रामिनीको. एन्ड ड्युरिङ द वर, लडाइँ सुरु भयो अरे कसैसँग, टु लिड द पिपल टु द ब्याटल फिल्ड, ग्रामिणीको काम हो. इज इट क्लियर? हि वाज अल्सो द चिफ अफ द भिलेज काउन्सिल अफ द ग्राम सभा. अब भिलेजमा ग्राम सभा हुन्थ्यो अर भिलेज काउन्सिल हामी भन्छ. ओके, हि वाज द हेड, ग्रामिणी वाज द हेड अफ द भिलेज काउन्सिल अर द ग्राम सभा. एन्ड स्पेसली वाट एभर द स्मल स्मल केसेस केम अराउन्ड स्पेसली इन द भिलेज एरिया, Gramini was the one to solve it out. He was the one to decide the small cases of village. He was responsible to get the king's orders executed. See, whatever, try to understand, whatever the orders were been given by the king, village mein execute ko le garnu paryo, Gramini le garnu paryo. Is it clear? He was the one to, he had to execute. He was the responsible to get the king's order executed. King le order dincha, tyo village mein tyo king ko order ko le lagu garnu parcha, Gramini le. In the village, Harichi, he held the most responsible post. See, at a higher level, village ma Harichi, another level-wise, at the top level, and the most responsible post were being held by Gramini. Is it clear? Dear student, let us move to the Sabha and the Samiti. See, there were two council of chosen members from among the people to assist the king. Next is known as Sabha and Samiti. See, two councils were there, and the members who have been chosen to that council among the people. Among the people, certain members who have been chosen, and those members who have been represented to these two councils. And these members were the one who used to assist the king, to help the king. One of them was called Sabha, while the other was called Samiti. Right? Village ma duita thiyo, euta sabha ra samiti, duita councils thiyo. There were two councils. One council was called Sabha and another council was called Samiti. Let's see what was Samiti and what was Sabha. The Samiti was a body that represent the whole tribe. Whole tribe le represent garne body lai sabha bhanthyo. Is it clear? Samiti. A samiti was a body who represented the whole tribe. Dollai tribe like tyo jun chai dollai jana cha tyo tribe like represent garne samiti, while the sabha was composed of only the distinguished member. Tyo sabha chai ke thyo? Distinguished, famous, popular, intellectual, kati lai chanera members sabha ma halthyo. That was sabha. Try to understand. The samiti is the body who represented the whole tribe, while the sabha was composed of only the distinguished chaneko member, the chosen members, like say sabha hunthyo. The members of the sabha were called the sabhasads, as its president was called sabhapati. Are whoever all the members were there, members of the sabha, yo sabha bhayo, sabha ko members lai ke bhanthyo, sabhasads. And head, okay, the president of the sabha was known as sabhapati. Is it clear? Got it? The members of the sabha were called the sabhasads, and the president of the sabha was called sabhapati. Free discussions were been held in sabha, and the resolution were passed by the majority vote. Teti belako chalan ajhai pani cha. Even today, we have got Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha, the two houses in the parliament, you know very well. Any sort of resolution has to be passed in the Lok Sabha, obviously it will be passed by the majority vote. Is it clear? Similarly, during that time also, the resolution were been passed, free discussions hunthyo Sabha ma, and whatever the resolution has to be passed, it was been passed by the majority vote. Its decision was applicable to all and everybody had to abide by this decision. Sabha le je decision lincha. Try to understand. Whatever the decisions was been taken by Sabha, it is applicable to all. Sabai le mannu parcha. It has to abide. It had to be abide by this decision. Sabai usko decision, Sabha le lieko decision, Sabai le mannu parcha. Is it clear? Got it? The Samiti was the council. Some it is kiyo in the other side. Council of the whole tribe and was like the present day parliament. Aile ko jun cha maile aghi pani hale, aile ko jun cha present day parliament cha, samiti cha tei ho. It is council for the whole tribe. Euta council hunthyo, tyo council will represent the whole tribe. Dallai tribe lai represent garcha. There was freedom of expression to every member. See, freedom thiyo teti bela. Try to understand. During the early Vedic time, you read Vedic Aryans ko bela ma, there was freedom of expression. You are free to express your views and ideas. Every member of that samiti, they were free to express their views and ideas, and the resolutions were carried out by the majority of vote. Samiti ma, resolution pass hunthyo, and that resolution kati bela pass hunthyo, if that resolution is been supported by majority vote. Is it clear? Yes, bande jyada bhayo ni tyo pass huncha, no bande jyada bhayo ni tyo reject huncha tyo resolutions. Try to understand. Is that clear? Okay. Even the king had to seek the cooperation of the samiti, which helped him strengthening his position. Even the king, mal agi bhane alekche, king don't have got the absolute power. The king was not autocrat. Agi bhanekche yani ra. Yeah, it's clear written. Even the king had to take the cooperation. He had to cooperate to the samiti. Then only he can make his power position much stronger. To make his position much stronger, the king also had to cooperate with the samiti at the time of the accession. Accession mane kyo? What is the meaning of accession? Accession means when the king is going to ascend the throne. Jab u rajgaddi ma basne bala ma mukut lai dincha, accession to the throne bhanchu hami. At that time, see, at that time the king had to take many vows in the presence of samiti. Jab kunai pani euta raja le rajgaddi ma basnu atekcha, mukut launu atekcha, that time Titibela, he has to make many vows, many promises. Kosko agari? Samiti ko agari. Try to understand. Is it clear? It's not a matter of joke. One king taking a vows in the time of his accession, in the presence of samiti, it's not a matter of joke. Yani rami ke butso. Here, the king was not all in all in power. The king did not have unlimited power. King had to walk according to the samiti. In the presence of samiti, the king has to take many vows at the time of accession. Maile bhani hale. The samiti could pass a resolution to remove an incompetent and cruel king. Hera yanera. Kole remove garnu parne raicha. Who can remove the king? It was the samiti. Hera samiti ka power bujha yanera. I am talking about during the Rig Vedic Aryans. The samiti had a power to remove the incompetent king. Incompetent bhaneko a king who is not able to rule properly. Is it clear? Our understanding? And a cruel king. If it has been proved, if the king has been proved to be cruel, he can be removed by the another king. Ab tyo kaam kole garda rahecha yahanera? Samiti le. Is it clear? The samiti has got the power. They can pass a resolution. If they feel it so, the king is not able to rule properly. The king is very cruel to his people. Then the samiti will pass the resolution. After passing the resolution, if the resolution has been passed by the majority vote, then that cruel and incompetent king can be removed from his throne. In this way, we can say that both this institution, the Sabha and the Samiti, had great importance, and they exercised control over the king so that he did not turn into an autocrat. Yesai karan the king cha autocrat hunthena. Because it is very much clear when we are coming to the conclusion, we can clearly state it that this both institution, yo duita institution, euta Sabha bhayo, arko Samiti bhayo, they had a great importance, and they had a power to control over the king, so that the king will not turn into autocrat. Tesai karan aghi maile bhaneko thie, the king is not an autocrat. Is it clear? The king don't have unlimited powers. Kinamane yahan chai yo time ma king lai chai kole control garera rakheko cha, sabha and samiti. Is it clear? Thus we can say that despite their monarchical system, there was glimpses of democracy in the administration of the Aryans. Herai at tete bela monarchy system thyo. A monarchy system bhaneko king ruled system ho. Monarchy system mathi huncha. Though the monarchy system was there, but there was a certain sign. There was a certain sign of democracy in the administrative system of the Aryans. Administration of Aryans ma teti bela. Okay, there was some sign of democracy. Democracy pani thiyo teti bela. Is it clear? Are you understanding? Monarchy system, okay. In the conclusion, we can say that monarchy system was there. But despite of the monarchical system, there was a sign of democracy in the administrative system of the Aryans. Bhanepachi, Aryans ko administrative setup ma chai democracy bhanne thiyo. The people had the right. They were free to express their views and ideas. Is that clear? Okay, now final point. Point number five. Yani raudai chu aba point number five. Method of warfare. Abo. Unako warfare ko war, ladai ko kasto tarika thiyo. The Aryans fought wars on foot. Unaru, they used to fight the war on foot or while riding on the horseback or riding on the chariots. This was the method of warfare, okay? While they were going to the war, either on the foot or riding on the horseback or riding the chariots, they used to fight the war. The kings and the nobles usually fought on the horseback. Aba horseback ma ko chariya ladai parthyo? The king and the nobles. Or in the chariots, rath ma. Okay, got it? While the infantry or the soldiers fought on foot. Infantry bhanne ke ho, the soldiers who specially carry the weapons and fight with the enemies on the foot, they are called infantry. Infantry or the soldiers, they used to fight on the foot. From the Rig Veda, we come to know that the chief weapons, ab teti bela unako chief weapons ke thiyo? Method of warfare. Inarko chief weapons. What were their chief weapons? Let us try to understand. From the Rig Veda. Main source Rig Veda bhandechu maile. From Rig Veda, let's see what were their chief weapons. Bows and arrows. Spears. Bhala bhancha hami space lai. Okay. And they used to wear armors. A-R-M-O-U-R-S. Armors. Bhaneko afno body lai guard garne. To protect themselves against the enemy charge. They used to wear the armors. They observed a noble code of war. They used to fight the war according to the law, according to the code of war. Actually, what are the rules and regulations of the war? They followed that. They never struck a foe who was asleep. Try to understand. Unale koile pani sutira ko dusman lai attack garthena. Try to understand. That is the reason why they observe a noble code of war. Lorai to gartyo. Tara unaru jati lorai ko ke cha rules and regulations ke cha. They used to follow that. They never struck. Unale kaile pani afno enemy who was asleep. Suti rako enemy lai kaile hamla garthen. Jasari. The Pakistanis had attacked the Indian army when they were sleeping, isn't it? Which you have already heard about these things. They never attack the defenseless or wounded. Just they, merema kune hatyar chaina. I am not able to defend myself. Unar aundai cha agi bardai cha. I am not able to defend myself. Malai unale attack garthaina. Because I don't have any weapons in my hand. Unale kahile attack garthaina. They never attack the wounded. Chot lageko. Like kahile pani attack garthaina. And remember, one above all this, one of the most important point is that they, the common people, were left unhurt. Common people like kaile pani chhundena unarle. They never hurt the common people. This is the reason why we can clearly say that these Aryans, they observed a noble code of war. In this way, finally, we may conclude that the Rig Vedic administration was a purely tribal. Yes. Finally, we can come to the conclusion. The administrative system of Rig Veda was a pure tribal system. As the tribes were always on the move, you know very well, tribes, ki was unako ek jagah permanent settlement chaina. They used to move from one place to another. There could be no stable government. Tesai karan unako stable euta permanent government thaina. Unar jaha gaera jaha set up bhayo, tyahi unale local government set garthyo. Is it clear? Are you understanding? Maile tribe ta bhandai chu. The tribes always, they used to move. They used to shift from one place to another. So that is the reason why they didn't have a permanent or a stable government. Also, there did not exist anything like civic or provincial administration. Unarko civic administration or a provincial administration. State government bhanne thiyena unarko. Is that clear? Because they didn't have a stable government. Unar jaha gaye jaha shift bhaye aaju yaha basiraksha. Okay. Yahi government banaye unarle. Local self government banaye. नेक्स्ट टाइम दे विल सिफ्ट फ्रम वान प्लेस टू अनदर, जुन जाउँमा जान्छ त्यहीँनिर उनीहरूले गभर्मेन्ट बनाउँछ. सो इन कन्क्लुजन वी क्यान से द्याट एज दे युज टु मुभ फ्रम वान प्लेस टु अनदर दे कुड बी नो स्टेबल गभर्मेन्ट, एन्ड एज दे कुड नट बी एनी स्टेबल गभर्मेन्ट दे डिन्ट ह्याड एनिथिङ लाइक सिभिक अर प्रोभिन्सियल एडमिनिस्ट्रेसन. ओके डियर चिल्ड्रेन, आई विल बी स्टपिङ आउट हियर नाउ. इन माई नेक्स्ट क्लास I'll be doing about the later Vedic civilization. Okay, thank you very much.